Welcome back, Daily Caller. Omeed and I are here. It's Friday, so you know that means we're doing another episode of Wall Street Meets Washington. We've got a lot to talk about. A lot of really abysmal numbers came out from labor and the Department of Commerce today, but we're sort of used to that at that point. There are some glimmers of hope that we're going to pull out from all of this. We're also going to do a deep dive later on Omeed's op-ed, talking about the relevance of deficits in the current fiscal climate. Well, let's start with talking about the numbers that came out Thursday. Unemployment, horrible. GDP shrank tremendously in the first quarter. What's the biggest standout data point that you're monitoring right now, Omeed?
Yeah, I mean, you know, every week we come on here and we think, oh, it's about 3 million new claims of unemployment being filed. And it's just devastating, not only from a personal standpoint, when you think about emotionally what people are going through that are having to deal with this. And then when you just look at the sheer amount of them, it's staggering with almost no historical precedent. So we've got to keep the focus on that because those are the folks that need the most help. And that's why on mediums like this, we've got to get the word out and pressure our policymakers to make sure they're taking care of people. And I'm sure we're going to talk a little bit about how they're doing that.
Right.
Respect to PPP and other helicopter payments that we've been stressing on this show for the past couple months. In particular, though, what stood out to me is even though we had some of a moderate improvement in that the rate of unemployment insurance being claims being filed decreased subtly or slightly down to around 2.1 was the headline number.
Yeah.
It doesn't address these PUAs, actually.
Right. And now, what does that stand for the folks out there who don't know?
Right. So that is Pandemic Unemployment Assistance, if I'm not mistaken, is the acronym, right? Yeah. So this is a really interesting data point that we haven't spoken about before. And it refers, it's a new program because people should know, and they probably do, that if you weren't employed, right, by a corporation and you were an independent contractor, you weren't eligible for unemployment insurance.
Right.
And because of the pandemic, they passed part of the CARES Act, this program that was going to entitle folks who were independent contractors. And we started to touch in the past a little about the gig economy. My calculation is that's almost 15% of our economy now are independent contractors working for these new businesses like Uber and Lyft as to how they make their income or anything that makes them self-employed where they don't work at a big business. They needed to be taken care of. And this type of insurance program was there to help them. If you look at the numbers, the 2.1 million for this week, it's my sense that many states are not reporting these numbers as well. So you might want to add close to 15 to 20% on the unemployment numbers we see, making it even all the more horrifying, because I'm not sure the data is picking up all of these independent contractors who are now out of work as well.
Yeah, it's a scary point. I mean, you think about the way that, one, technology makes our lives easier. It also makes it significantly harder when we're trying to address some of these unprecedented problems. And obviously, contract work has been a thing basically as long as the United States has been in the industrial age or the post-industrial age, rather. But technology, like you pointed out, Uber and all these work-from-home apps that you can sign up for and meter your own time out, that's something that the folks at the government didn't necessarily think about when they were crafting the CARES Act. And just in the same way that we talked about how all the sole proprietors sort of got screwed in the way that PPP was rolled out, these people are probably going to need assistance down the line. And we saw Mitch McConnell say just on Thursday that it's probably going to be at least another month before Congress passes another care package. So what's going to happen to these people in the interim? I will say on the jobs report, there is one good sign of hope that I saw, and that it's for the first time under the pandemic, there was a decrease in the number of continuing unemployment claims. That's basically people who filed a claim in the past have continued to receive weekly benefits. And the reason that they're no longer receiving benefits is because they've re-entered the workforce. That's an obvious indicator that some of these industries are starting to reopen. Businesses are doing business, for lack of a better word. And we're starting to see that uptick again. I guess the question in my mind is it a little too late to sort of stem the massive economic fallout that we're going to see? We've seen tons of companies already, big ones too, like Boeing is saying that they're going to be cutting hundreds of thousands of or thousands of employees rather. And we're seeing a lot of the old school retailers who we know haven't been doing super well, like Neiman Marcus, are now filing for bankruptcy. What's your big takeaway on how these companies are going to be able to float, the ones that aren't an Amazon, that aren't a Google, but established companies who didn't maybe get a PPP loan, are they going to be able to float their employees through the phase one and two process before we get to the eventually fully reopened economy again?
Yeah, so taking a few of those in order, I mean, absolutely on unemployment, stay tuned for July because that's when the additional $600 that we're given are going to roll off. So right. It'll be interesting to see the middle and lower tier paying jobs that it was actually incentivized to collect that rather than going back to work. Mm-hmm. To what extent that will change, and that also corresponds to some of these economies opening up on a state-by-state basis. And you're right, it's definitely declining, but again, you got to focus on this PUA number that we talked about too and add that back in. So it's definitely concerning, but yes, you're always happy to see the rate reduce slightly. And I hope that, as these economies continue to open, that number will continue to dissipate. But you're absolutely right. There are companies that are left here in purgatory. They really don't fit in nicely to either being thriving in this environment because they're tech-enabled or received a bailout. And so they're kind of what we call COVID casualties. Boeing, I point out, which is really one of the most important American companies around, because that's basically Boeing is America and Airbus is in Europe. There are only two games in town.
Right.
But airlines are not leasing from them, and that's their primary business. So unfortunately, they were going to have to lay some folks off. I'd point out, though, that they did not take government assistance.
Right.
They rejected it. And I do think that maybe that seems certainly like a noble step on its face. It's unfortunate if that decision led to these layoffs, though, because had they taken the government assistance, they'd be met with a lot of resistance if they laid off anybody, because people would not feel comfortable with that, and rightfully so. So I think that's something to consider. They did do the largest bond deal like in history, almost over $20 billion, I think, if I'm not mistaken, in order to raise capital for this period of time. And it was met quite nicely. They had that successful bond offering. I would point out, though, that just didn't happen. The only reason that bond deal, and a lot of people aren't making this connection, was able to happen is because of the Fed liquidity programs. So the Fed had been there to prop up the bond market with one of the first topics we spoke about several months ago, which was that, $4 trillion of liquidity that they were pumping in through their bond buying program, as well as everything else. Then Boeing would not have been able to perform that very, very large offering that is obviously going to bridge the company to the other side. So I think it's going to accelerate the destruction of old world retailers that have only brick and mortar. And in fact, you see that with the kind of companies that have already filed for bankruptcy and are probably going to. But some of them are so obviously correlated to the economy slowing down. When you look at a company like Hertz renting cars, you don't have the type of commerce and travel, and therefore no one's going to the airport and needs to have a rental car. And there's only so long they can hold on. So this is just going to increase the pressure to open up the economy in some way, which we've obviously discussed quite a bit.
Yeah, it's an interesting position. I do want to make one more point on Boeing, and it's that you'd think of all the companies out there that are struggling right now, one like Boeing would eventually be able to float just given the way that aerospace naturally applies to national security. You'd think that they would never necessarily run out of contracts from the government or, whatever that they could do. You'd think that the manufacturing would be all right there. But ultimately, it is, again, just a factor of the states reopening. Can they actually physically, hold the capacity in the factories and the manufacturing plants to have their full assembly line in order to make having people coming back to work actually make sense from a dollar standpoint?
Yeah, and their customers are airlines. So, that's one of the hardest hit businesses. So even with the bailout the airlines got, I mean, I've read like JetBlue CEO says that barely buys them like 6 months to a year. That's how bad it is. So they really are hurting as well. And so this, again, demonstrates how we need to fully appreciate the supply chain and every part of the integrated economy per sector as to how many of these companies interact with one another. Just because one part isn't doing well, it's going to have a domino effect on all their customer contracts as well.
So we've covered doom and gloom pretty extensively in the beginning part of this episode. I want to talk a little bit about the boom that we're seeing right now, because while everyday workers are hurting, everyone's out of work, we know that this is not a good space to be in. The markets continue to just perform like nobody's business. They did close slightly down on Thursday. That was to do with a little bit of an announcement that the president made about a possible tete-a-tete with China that's coming up. That being said, everyone's killing it these days. I mean, are we surprised that it's looking like we're going to get a U-shaped recovery in the stock market at least? Or is this something that's good, it's bad? I mean, obviously, we're going to talk about it later on once we get into your definite or your deficit explainer with how rates affect the markets. But I mean, shouldn't people be angry about this? They're out of work. You're hurting. Yet the rich keep getting richer.
No, I mean, I think it's been a nice theme that we've had, a narrative to the show, is that we've been hitting this point every single time. You're not going to let the viewers forget about this, that there really are these two economies, and the market continues to benefit and not seem totally connected to the fundamentals. This has been a long-term issue with the market, though. I mean, it was one of the priciest markets pre-COVID that we've ever had on record anyway, as a multiple to earnings for the companies that are listed. So it's not new, and that's a macroeconomic issue that we could speak about towards the end of the episode. But as it relates to the current situation, I was saying that China has been replaced by vaccine trials for what's been driving the market. Yes. I think also just the bullishness on the reopenings and then the liquidity and low interest rates. All of those are a perfect storm for the type of market gains that we've been having. And yes, they disproportionately benefit one part of our society. And that's why the Fed was right in their comments recently that Powell was making about Main Street and small to medium-sized businesses potentially being the Achilles heel of the economy. They're the ones that are creating a lot of the jobs, and we need to take care of them, because that's not affected by the stock market gains. You know, that helps the large multinational businesses, to a lesser extent their employees, obviously, and then the speculating class. So we should be upset about it. You can't have one part of the economy do well. It's going to require more structural programs, and then, of course, much larger structural shifts that we should continue to talk about in every episode to help people that are not benefited by a market economy doing well. And that goes all the way back to education, which we've described, healthcare issues. All of those things have to work in tandem if you're going to make it so that the economy kind of works for everyone. And it just isn't doing that right now. So maybe COVID will be an opportunity for us to reexamine this even further and try to address some of it. But it seems like some of these programs structurally are going to help it. And yes, I mean, you know, if the market's going to dip on news about China, so be it. Honestly, you've spoken about that. That's an overdue topic. Their action against Hong Kong, as well as also parts of India that are not as much reported over the past couple of days, definitely show a bellicose attitude. They know they're under attack or in threat, and so they're acting quite aggressively, and the president is right to hopefully take counteractive measures that he'll announce at the end of this week. And if that's going to hurt the bottom lines of some multinationals, as we've spoken about ad nauseum here, so be it. This is a national security issue, and I hope that it will cause many of them to diversify their supply chains outside of China.
Yeah, it's an interesting position to be in, because from a generational standpoint, at least, and this is me taking off my reporter hat and just being a millennial for a second, as long as I've, you know, had my foot out in the real world, had to worry about finances at all, I've basically been saddled with back-to-back recessions over the course of, you know, a decade and a half. And I think for someone who's my age, you look at the way that the system is set up, and if you weren't born with a silver spoon in your mouth, you look at the fact that, okay, I've got $200,000 in student debt from college, which I was told I had to go to get a good paying job to start a family. Like, how am I going to ever get out from under that? And then ultimately, you know, there are political ramifications from that. And I don't know if that's going to make people vote conservative or make people vote liberal. But ultimately, I think it's going to make people vote out of office the politicians from both parties who are currently at the reins of this thing. So again, this is something we've talked about at length on this show. If Congress and the executive branch don't get their act together, this is going to be like a full-on political revolution because people won't stand for this anymore.
It's such a good point. I mean, I think that, and the revolution will be driven by, you know, your generation. I mean, I have basically one foot in yours. I'm 1 year shy of being a millennial myself. So,
well, you look like a millennial. So
that I know. So thank you for that. But I appreciate it. And I try hard to stay millennial status, aesthetically at least. But I guess I'm the youngest possible Gen Xer, right? And right. So the Gen Xers have kind of, you know, as a generation, have not made much noise. And But baby boomers, because of how many of them are, can still control and you know, have the grip on power. And, you know, every president has effectively been a baby boomer since basically the, I think, late 80s or early 90s, certainly since Clinton. And so there's a way of thought that comes with that generation. And so it's a nice way to put it, and certainly a troubling one for millennials and the younger part of my generation as well, because, you know, I graduated college and that same year 9/11 happened. So, you know, it and then we had a couple years, but then you had the financial crisis, you know, not too long thereafter. And we'll probably get to this because my op-ed talks about the same period of time, which is which should be analyzed. It's really, really tough. And I think we've started to see that revolution you're referring to. I think 2016 was the first step toward it. Donald Trump isn't your typical conservative. You start to see a realignment that's occurring. We start to see orthodoxy on either side being blurred. And we start to see new forms of political ideologies forming, not to mention cultural ramifications of this. When you fight the wars we did and you only send certain segments of our society and people can't find jobs, they think the entire economy's against them, and they wouldn't be wrong, then they aren't able to start families. They aren't able to buy homes. And we're putting off marriage rates are at the lowest they've ever been. And so is reproductive rates as well, as far as having children. So there are serious cultural issues that we're going to deal with from all this economic calamity that your generation has had to deal with. And so I do think that, you know, the baby boomers' time literally needs to be really on its last few seconds here to get them out and get some new ideas from either Gen X and millennials, who are the ones that are going to have to carry the torch going forward. Because otherwise, you're going to have more and more anger towards the status quo. And quite frankly, that's why, you know, President Trump was elected in the way that he was, is that he muddled the water so much by creating policies that resonated with Americans from actually both sides. Mm-hmm. And that's why the battleground became the industrial Midwest, which is actually the part of the United States that has been most disproportionately affected by a lot of the topics you're referring to. And that's why you saw the anger there. And I think it's going to continue to be in that part of the United States and start expanding too, especially when you see some of the destruction that's going to occur in major metropolitan cities as a result of COVID.
Yeah, I think this is an excellent place to segue into our next topic. There was a vote on Thursday about a restructuring of the PPP program, but you just touched on how political ideologies are getting rewritten right now. This is more of a regression from some of the conservatives. I'm not saying that in a bad way, but this sort of reining in of the worker-focused take to sending aid out. This is more of a runway for some of the companies, the small businesses, to make sure that the loans that they received are going to actually float them. So this bill was authored by Chip Roy out of Texas. It changed the 75% payroll requirement for all of these loans. It extended the amount of time that these companies can, one, pay back the government, and two, actually distribute wealth to their employees. Do you think that these new changes to the program unfairly benefit the companies? Will some of that trickle down to the workers, or do you see this as more of a rollback into the traditional corporate conservative take on how to handle this problem?
Well, so when I think they're getting rid of some of the most unpopular provisions in the PPP. That created a lot of kind of strings attached with the money. So it sounds to me like they're opening up more leeway for the business owner. Is that your understanding? Because that's what I thought.
Certainly, yeah, it is. Right. It is. Definitely yeah. is, yeah.
And so if we accept the premise that public companies probably aren't taking this money, and neither because they've been told not to, and venture-backed companies aren't really taking it, then you start to probably hit the kind of mainstream-type businesses that really need the help. And so anything that's going to give those kinds of companies more help and leeway, I'm 100% in favor of. Because, you know, that's really going to be the lifeblood of any recovery for average Americans.
Right.
And we are going to see those companies become more important, I think, just to America generally, because a lot of people are probably not going to be as interested in working for large corporate businesses in major metropolitan areas. And in fact, the one bright spot that we haven't addressed was I was shocked to see the new data on housing.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, definitely. I was expecting, and this dovetails our point about people moving out of major cities, and it's the decay of cities as a result of COVID. I saw that actually they were expecting new home sales to be down 22% in April. Guess what? It was up a percent. And we had mortgage applications up over 9% on for new home sales. And that's obviously driven by, which we'll talk about soon, the low rate environment that we're in, that it's great to take advantage of that. But primarily the home buying is taking place in more suburban and rural areas because people are trying to now focus on having more space, being out of these densely populated areas and crammed in apartments. None of the benefits that I'm talking about or the gains had anything to do with New York City. New York City is in a terrible state as it relates to, you know, home buying. People are actually, it's an exodus, frankly, is what the data is showing. And you might, after 20 years of a major metropolitan renaissance that was predicated upon the kind of businesses that do entertainment and get people together like Broadway and shows and large retail stores and restaurants, are all the things that are hurting the most. And that's really what city life was predicated upon. But if you pull that out, not to mention the fiscal situation that we've talked about as well, you're really going to start seeing some serious problems for them. And that's why the home sales are up for the types of parts of the country that we're talking about.
That's an interesting point. And it's nice to see the data back up our hypotheses about the migration patterns. Obviously, New York is getting hammered right now, but the New York Times, on the other hand, is outperforming just about every tech company because we are treating it as a tech company, not a publisher, on the market, except for Amazon. It's pretty astounding when you look at how they've been able to grow over the last several months, while other similar players in this space have had to lay off employees. They've suffered massive ad revenue decreases. The Daily Caller itself, luckily we run a tight ship, but we had an all staff meeting where everyone was like, look, everybody's going to have to work more just because the ad revenue is not out there. It's not a fault of our own. This is just the climate we're in, but they are diversified in terms of media. They have video. They have a massive podcast library. They also have the largest subscription-based newspaper, and that's print and digital in the world right now. What's your big takeaway from the New York Times overperforming compared to some of these other media slash tech companies?
Look, you're right. They have basically contorted themselves and probably successfully for Wall Street as a tech business. And that's predicated exactly on what you started referring to. They make their money and have pivoted and put all their emphasis on subscriptions. And that's how tech companies get the high valuations they do. It's effectively software as a service or SaaS. You charge a customer a monthly fee or an annual fee, and it's just repetitive, reoccurring revenue. Those are the best types of businesses. As you see, stocks like that are always the high flyers. Those are the tech companies. That's effectively what every software company has as their revenue driver. What they don't have is being reliant on advertising dollars. And that's usually the conventional way that newer media and media, generally speaking, even before online, had paid for itself, was through advertising dollars. So let's talk about the last period quarter where the Times has done well to a disproportionate effect than other media businesses. And that's primarily driven because of what's going on with advertising. The New York Times, by their own admission, in their last public filing, described how advertising is down 50%. Yet the stock is up because revenues are higher because they have more subscribers. Right. So the interesting observation about kind of media and journalism right now is that because of COVID and time, people have never been more interested in the news. And so you have more people clicking and reading the news than ever before. But the primary beneficiaries of those will be the media companies that generate their revenue through subscription business like they do, not the vast majority of businesses that don't have the kind of history and relationships and business model that the Times has been able to acquire, where they're charging their customers for a subscription and have a paywall. There's very few media businesses that can do that. And so they're stuck all fighting over the declining advertising dollars. And that's why the state of media is where it is, which is this kind of very bizarre juxtaposition of where people have never been more interested in it, but they can't really make profits and generate the kind of revenue they need to keep their employees on, and you've had the mass layoffs you've had. So that's a really important point. And it's too bad because people lament the state of the mainstream media. And in fact, you know, to a certain extent, the Daily Caller and other upstarts are responses to that. I mean, the mainstream media is a nice sounding alliteration, but I think a more appropriate term is corporate owned media.
Yes.
Or billionaire owned media.
I love it even more.
Pockets that they fall into. Right. All of people's news in the most conventional players are either owned by multinational corporate conglomerates or billionaires. Let's just talk about a few. So that's why it's so hard to do an apples to apples public company comparison in the New York Times, because they're one of the few that don't necessarily fall into one of those two neat categories. By the way, the Times has got a ton of flaws. This is not in any way, shape, or form an endorsement of them. I'm simply describing their business model. And we could plug a bunch of holes into them. But for now, let's move on to some of the others. So the Washington Post, has been well documented, is by Bezos, right?
Oh, yeah.
Let's take Bloomberg. Oh, it's owned by, you know, Bloomberg.
Mike Bloomberg. You guys remember, failed presidential candidate, Mike Bloomberg.
CNN, AT&T.
Right.
MSNBC, NBC, Comcast, ABC, Disney. I mean, the list goes on. And this, and you know, News Corp, which is Fox, you know, Fox has its own company and the news has its own company, News Corp. So the Wall Street Journal goes up to News Corp, which is ultimately controlled by Murdoch. And same with the Fox Corporation, Murdoch, billionaire. So that's really the state of conventional media. So that doesn't mean that the journalists working there are bad people or unethical. What it does mean, though, is that a very small group of, let's say, 85% of news that's consumed is owned by, you know, 6 to 7 humans and entities. Okay. Right. And so when you're looking for diversity of thought, this is the vacuum that upstart media publications are trying to take on. Many of them are venture backed. But until they can diversify their revenues outside of just advertising, that's going to be the struggle for them, because there's clearly a need. If you just think about conservative, which is going like left-wing media, half the country likes to watch Fox, but now you have all these other options on that side of the country that can move in. And you have, you know, on the network side, things like, you know, I think it's OAN or Newsmax and other more right-leaning networks that are trying to take some of the Fox pie, because Fox for so long had owned that entire half of the country. And now you're seeing the competition that's coming in there. It's going to be a fascinating space to watch. And it's great that you and I are working at a very thoughtful, you know, periodical here that is trying to challenge conventional thinking and giving different perspectives, because that's important. People aren't getting that.
Yeah, I think that's that just goes to show the work that we're doing at the Daily Caller. I mean, you think about, we've been around for 10 years. I wouldn't call us, you know, fledgling by any means. We, based on our total revenue and our operating capital, we would certainly fall under the startup category. But to be able to compete against some of these players like the Gray Lady, New York Times, or even Fox and conservative media, I mean, you said it before, it's not an apples to apples comparison.
Right.
And I think the pandemic is showing that more so than during a normal news climate. We're running out of time, so I want to devote the rest of the show to our bulk topic for today. If you guys haven't read it yet, I'll put the link in the article on the website. But Omeed did a fantastic piece on why deficits don't really matter anymore, but maybe they should. I don't want to crush your baby. Why don't you give us a brief rundown of why they don't seem to matter anymore, and I'll ping you back with a couple of devil's advocate questions for the more uninformed folks in the room.
Yeah, sure. I mean, listen, this is something I've been thinking about for a long time. I actually read an article Foreign Affairs that was drafted by Larry Summers, who used to be, I think the Treasury Secretary at one point. He certainly worked for the Obama administration and the Clinton administration. And he's a more or less a Keynesian. And I was just fascinated by what I've seen as an evolution over the last 20 years, with the deficits kind of becoming a primary political topic and then not. And I was trying to understand why both parties, when they get into power, you know, seem to not care about it, when in fact, was not the case as recently as the 90s, when I was first working in politics in the late 90s, that one of the biggest issues at that time was the balanced budget. And in fact, the Clinton administration's surplus that they achieved along with the Republican House. But yet since that time, I wanted to craft just first a historical rendering of what had happened to the deficit and how it's exploded over the last 20 years for a variety of reasons, which are not including but not limited to tax cuts, foreign wars, and other major expenditures on the social services side. And yet, whatever the party is outside, they typically used to chirp about, you know, wasteful spending. Certainly, mm-hmm. we're doing that to Obama for most of his tenure, those 8 years. But yet, now that they control, or did control, both houses for a period of time and do have the presidency, no one seems to mention it anymore. And it just keeps getting bigger and bigger. For purposes of your viewers being informed, it was supposed to be over $1 trillion, the deficit, before COVID. Now it's going to be over $3 trillion. Horrible situation. So that's the state of the state. Why don't people care anymore? I have 2 points, and this is my thesis, and I don't want to get too wonky because it's pretty complicated, so it's best that people read the op-ed. But frankly, I have it that there's the politicization of monetary policy, and that's the Fed. The Fed controls short-term rates, which is what people think about when they want to see what the rate is on their bank, the savings account, as well as their mortgages or car loans. And the Fed directly controls that, and they're the ones, that's when they cut rates. For when they want to juice the economy because they think it might be slowing down.
Like they're doing right now.
Exactly. So, you know, times get bad. And like you pointed out, it's been like that for a long time for you because all you know are bad times. And you've basically had zero interest rates on the short term side your entire professional career into probably college and high school. So that's the world you know. That wasn't always the case. Certainly wasn't when people like Volcker were the head of the Fed. You had, you know, interest rates in the teens in the 70s. Okay. And then on the other side, which is very interesting to me as like a market participant and a banker, is that the bond market was the kind of other disciplinarian on long-term rates. So we've talked about how other countries own our debt. What would happen in the past is if you were running irresponsibly your deficits and weren't being a good steward of your sovereign, of your country, then the bond vigilantes, the bond market would sell your sovereign debt and then your borrowing costs would go up. So as an example, the rate on the 10-year would go up from where it is now. It's only at around a couple percent, maybe even less actually today. And it would drive up to the teens. That rate, as I've described to your viewers before, typically correlates to how risky people think the country is. And yet, despite the country, America, by every metric, becoming more risky because we're running a higher deficit, that rate continues to go down. Mm. And it was this unbelievable anomaly that I couldn't explain until I spent more time looking at it. And I came up with a thesis that over the last 20 years, the only other thing that's changed is that capital markets or the bond market has globalized. So now people can invest in many different places, the sovereign debt in outside of the US. If you want something riskier, go invest in, you know, Italian bonds and you'll get a much higher coupon because of the risk of default. But also you have capital flows from all different parts of the world now that competed against people. So you have flows from the Middle East, from China that come in. China and Japan and Brazil are three of the top four owners of our sovereign debt. So all of these reasons have made the U.S. the best game in town because now bond markets are relative, not absolute. Right, and it's a place where you can still get some yield, unlike Japan or Europe, which are negative yields, but also know that you've got the full faith and credit, right, of the U.S. and it's not going to default on the bonds like somewhere like Argentina has. And so that's why the pensions, the mutual funds, all the people that need to drive up some yield because they can't get anywhere else but the stock market are investing in the U.S. So that's like a 4-minute primer on a very complicated topic. But the last point to take away is if I've now proved to you, and I think I have, that deficits don't matter, then the question has to be asked, why don't we spend money on everything? Why don't we have universal healthcare? Why don't we have free higher education for all? And trust me, people are taking notice of this. The advisor to Bernie Sanders' campaign is an economist. She has a theory called modern monetary theory, which says you can print money and pay for everything. And no one's really been able to go against that on an economic basis because of the two things I just pointed out to you. So I say, let's talk about the cultural and policy implications if we do pay for everything. And I believe that would result in a society that would no longer look like America, one that's based on hard work, entrepreneurship, because we really don't have a culture outside of that. This is a very diverse nation of immigrants that runs a federal system. So if you take away that underpinning, you're going to have an unambitious society that is going to hurt growth, and our standing in the world is predicated upon that growth.
It's an interesting juxtaposition because on the one hand, you have all these countries, because they are buying up the U.S.'s sovereign debt, they will never let the strength of the dollar falter because that's what their own economic strength is based on. Yet at the other side, I mean, that makes basically will lead to a culture, to a country that doesn't look like America anymore. So it sounds like to me, and I, you know, this might be blind optimism, we could take advantage of this sort of economic paradox we find ourselves in, while still sort of instilling a return to the exceptionalism that made America great in the 50s, and you know that we saw great prosperity through the 70s, and the you know that that sort of started to wane during the Cultural Revolution. But it seems like, and at least the way the political realignment is shaping up, we might be having a cultural realignment that gives us the best of both worlds. At least that's what I would hope for. I'd like to think that we could do that as a country, but it's a big ask, and it's I guess we'll just have to wait and see if we can do that. Otherwise, you know, it's not going to be America anymore.
Right, but I mean that's why you see a Republican president talking about infrastructure, which would have never happened, right? So, and now he's doing it a different way. Your typical Democrat would have used it through stimulus, but he's going to use the debt. He's going to use the cheap debt I'm talking about to finance it. All right, he'll just add more debt to the country and finance it that way because rates are effectively zero. So that's how you might achieve a policy gain, taking advantage of this bizarre situation that I've identified. But again, like, and then we've got to address healthcare and education because those two things have exploded over the last 20 years as cost to average Americans. Consumer prices have stayed low because of the bargain that we've made with China, where they own our debt and keep the dollar strong to buy their products. Okay, that's why that's happening. But that hasn't addressed healthcare and education. So if we can spend more now and we accept that, then how do we spend more but spend wisely? Because just throwing money at a problem isn't the right solution. But we've got to get those two areas of our country right, because that's what's also creating the disparity that we keep addressing here with the two economies.
Well, hopefully we can eventually get to spending money wisely. Again, if more people in the government started watching this show, maybe we'd get there sooner than later. But anyway, that's about all the time we've got for today. He's Omeed Malik. I'm Christian Datoc. Go hit subscribe if you haven't done it already. And we'll see you guys next Friday for another episode of Wall Street Meets Washington.
Take care.